a very special day today. David E. Kirkland, PhD, JD, is an author, activist, cultural critic, educator, and researcher. His transdisciplinary scholarship demonstrates a deep commitment to equity and explores the intersections between language, race, gender, and urban youth culture through the lens of literacy. He has spent the past decade analyzing the culture, language, and text of groups of urban American youth. Additionally, his expertise includes urban teacher preparation and school improvement. Dr. Kirkland has had quite a comprehensive, impressive, and dynamic career. He started as a teacher and administrator in Michigan before earning his PhD at Michigan State. His commitment to learning has also led him to more recently complete a JD at the University of Michigan. He is currently an associate professor of English and urban education at New York University, as well as the director for the Metropolitan Center for Research on Equity and Transformation of Schools. A prolific writer and presenter, Dr. Kirkland has published more than 70 articles, books, and book chapters, and has delivered more than 100 presentations. His book, A Search Past Silence, The Literacy Lives of Young Black Men, has won numerous accolades, including the 2014 AESA Critics' Choice Award and the 2014 NCTE David H. Russell Award for Distinguished Research in the Teaching of English. His scholarship has been funded by the National Academy of Education, the Spencer Foundation, and the Ford Foundation, among other institutions. I would just like to add a couple of personal observations. Dr. Kirkland is truly one of the scholars in the field who embodies, in his day-to-day interactions with people, the values he researches and argues for in his work: intellectual generosity and expansiveness, as well as a genuine sense of care and humanity. He walks the walk of equity. Second, I have used A Search Past Silence in several of my doctoral courses here at Penn, courses I teach for RWL, as well as the mid-career program, and is one of the few academic texts that never fails to engage profoundly both students' hearts and minds, which are really inseparable. Dr. Kirkland's research and wisdom has had a transformative impact on myself and the learning and scholarly imaginations of many of our students here at Penn. Please give a warm welcome to Dr. Kirkland.
I'm gonna stand back here because I have some buttons that I have to push in order to make the slides go. I hope that you all don't mind. I wanna thank Gerald for, you know, just a warm introduction, you know, and for being such a warm host. I've been not only a fan of Gerald's work, but also a colleague of his, you know, for many years. I also wanna thank, you know, Tama Grossman, you know, for the kind invitation, for, you know, having me here, you know, at this prestigious institution, an institution that, you know, I humbly, you know, come to. Without the work, you know, pioneering and groundbreaking work of Sean Harper, you know, this moment wouldn't be, you know, impossible either. You know, I thank Sean and all of his distinguished, you know, all of my distinguished colleagues at the Center for Race and Equity, my good friend Peter Keough, and there are so many others of you to name, Nora Gross. I want to thank, you know, to my friend and colleague, you know, Ebony Thomas, you know, for, you know, just keeping it real. She's been, you know, one of those trailblazers in her own work, and I appreciate, you know, her. And I thank, you know, so many other people who have come before me. And I want to thank you for laboring out, you know, on a Wednesday afternoon just to hear my humble thoughts about education, black males, you know, in literacy. Hopefully, toward the end of this talk, things can come together and we can have a conversation. Chimamanda Adichie says that stories matter. Many stories matter. Stories have been used to dispossess and to malign, but stories can also be used to empower and to humanize. Stories can break the dignity of a people, but stories can also repair that broken dignity. Today I want to start this presentation for another person that I want to thank who couldn't be in a room here with us, and it's Diana. Diana and I were talking this morning about this presentation and where it should go, and I said, Diana, I want to start with the story of students. because it's the stories of students that matter. And she encouraged me and compelled me to share the story of the student that I know best. So if you indulge me for about 5 minutes, I want to share with you the story of the student I know best. Get over here. We're going to whoop your butt talking all that stuff in class. Now what's up? Hey man, giddy. He getting away. Where did he go? Those were the last words I heard those boys saying. The last I saw them were the mounting fists pouring upon my head. This had become too routine in my neighborhood. Every day a posse or gang of boys would choose someone to assault. Today I was their selection, but I was running, and the three large boys didn't catch me. This was the single code of living on Detroit's east side. That is, do whatever it takes to survive. I didn't understand why those dudes were chasing me. I had heard one of them mention that they were going to get me next for showing off in class. All I had done was answer a few questions that our teacher asked, so that they teased me, calling me a teacher-pleasing nerd. But here I was again, running. It became all too common now. Whenever I was afraid, I ran. Whenever I was in any trouble, I ran. Now again, I found myself running. Running was my way of coping with the brutal situation of a depleted city. I hadn't witnessed the fall of Detroit. It probably took place years before my birth. Yet I lived daily in its death. I participated in its funeral. I carried its tomb. Detroit was no longer a mecca for the economic upliftment of people. By the mid-1980s, the city had been transformed into a dark urban dungeon that fettered people into an existence comparable to slavery. All the days that I lived in Detroit, I felt enslaved. The event of being jumped and beaten for no reason was just another example of my thrall. My running was simply an attempt to find freedom. That day, I run home to my mother. She is a beautiful woman with blazing brown eyes. Her complexion is a sparkling bronze, and her features wear what the Bible terms strength and dignity. Standing no higher than 4 feet 9 inches, to me, she is a giant. Looking into her consuming eyes is like looking into a mirror. Many times I have been told how much I resembled my mother. She alone cared for my sister and me, but she had our company in her suffering. The city did not deal well with single mothers, especially those like my mother, untamed and somewhat possessed by wild spirits. For this freedom, she didn't work a job. Instead, she was demoted to social patient status, victimized by the cruel asylum of the welfare program that the state afforded many of these unfortunate cases. Every year that my mother participated in that unforgiving program, her conscience shivered like a junkie's, and her soul bled red like the burning embers of coal. She became somewhat of a dependent child herself on this program, and then on others. You see, my mother was a prostitute. So when I returned to her home, I found her standing by the time-beaten screen door that hung before her front wall. She was standing there, shouting those words, screaming them as she argued with one of her friends. Get out of my house. If you ain't got no money, it's nothing you can get here. I got 2 kids I'm trying to raise. And I don't need to take this, and I don't need you sucking the life out of me. Lena, why are you tripping? I don't need to take this from you. And then he slapped her across her beautiful face. It seemed as though he had slapped away some of her beautiful features, portions of a golden bronze dulled in their splendor. I was angry, but afraid. I ran into her house to my room. I could not understand why she had let him slap her. I could not resolve why my 7-year-old man-child self could not protect my mother. I could not resolve why when he had slapped her, I felt the blunt force behind the thrust of his blast. I could not resolve why the sound of the slap was magnified, as though the echoes of the three large boys beating me in my head had reached my mother. I could not resolve why all of this was happening, or why it seemed to happen so often, so abundantly. As I sat in my room alone, I began to cry. My tears formed into words, settled into poetry. They pasted my boyhood thoughts into a contingency of spots, a notebook charged with monitoring my life. The tears filled, and the pages captured their water in words, and I cried. And wished that someday there would come an end to the strife that followed me. Thus I created a world of my own in my room. It was a place that only I understood. It separated me from the rest of the world. More importantly, it separated me from my concerns. I had a bed in my room which seemed to get more comfortable as each night passed. It was given to my mother by a sister who had recently bought her son's new beds. My mom gave one of the beds to me, arguing what I suspected about the floor, that it was no bed. I took the bed that my mother gave me and transformed it into a vehicle that allowed me to travel in my sleep. Here I dreamt of peace and happiness. I explored moments of solace, times when children would compliment me for being intelligent instead of beating me. I bore witness to the freedom of imagination, the still scene of this concept, freedom, which was so vivid in my imagination became my destination. Although I ran steel, the barb of my knees now pointed in this direction. I knew from my dreams that freedom was far from where I stood. It was hidden in a place where my imagination had taken me. It was in a place buried deeply within my dreams. It was not Detroit. As I sat in my room, I heard a loud cry. It was my mother. She was running through the house as if someone were chasing her, screaming that unfulfilled question, why? The depth of her tears were as oceans touching sky, surrendering rain. They were like small images of hope that baptized her troubled soul and cleansed her naked spirit. I watched my mother from the door of my room. I watched her, and a tear passed by my eyes. She looked at me. I think she saw the bruises bearing upon my forehead. She began to walk toward me. She came into my room, sat on the side of the bed next to me, and continued to cry. I grabbed her with all the sympathy in my arms and held her there. She lay there crying like a baby in my arms and fell asleep. I held her until she awakened. While she slept, I discovered the imprint of a man's hand on the side of her face. It was an awful bruise that now made me ask, why? I was then reminded of what she had once told me about living in a city. You're in a ghetto, boy. Don't nobody care about how you feel. You got to do what it takes to survive. But I did care what others felt. More importantly, I cared about how she felt and wondered why anyone had to live in a ghetto. So I share my story for a couple reasons. One reason is in talking about black males, it's hard for me to talk about a black male without, you know, putting myself in the story because I am a black male. The other reason I talk about myself in the story around black males as I am a black male in the story is because I understand that statistics like this need to be given shape and context. What we know in literacy education, at least from a quantitative perspective, is that gaps persist. And we know that these achievement gaps worsen as young black men experience school. We see these growing gaps from fourth to eighth grade. The trajectory of the gap, not necessarily, you know, so it would be one thing if the gap was consistent, but the trajectory of the gap, you know, seems to expand. We also know that nearly 70% of black fourth grade boys read below grade level compared to 27% of white children. That even Hispanic and Asian fourth graders fare better on reading exams than black males, although English is their second language. We know that black males are at the bottom or near the bottom of all achievement categories and are grossly overrepresented among school suspensions, dropouts, and special education tracts. In some ways, to me, this is a single story. If the only thing that I knew of black males were these statistics, for me, there would be reason to doubt. If the only thing that I knew of my story is the idea that I came from a mother who lived in a brothel who was a prostitute, then there would be reason for me to sound alarm. I share the story because the stories of black males are complex. And one argument that I want to make today is that our research around them must be as complex. Point in case. I shared my story. My mother lived in a brothel because of very interesting circumstances. But my story didn't end there. I get to stand before you with 6 degrees, PhD, a JD, 2 MA degrees, and 2 PA degrees. I don't say that to brag. I say that to point out the larger qualitative reality. Like, even while we have statistics that are steeped in, you know, crisis,
The qualitative scholarship has consistently pointed out that youth, regardless of race and gender, actively read and write for about 10 years. This idea of beginning to interrupt the type of deficit reality that we see in a particular type of scholarship has shaped my own work, just as it shapes my narrative. Peering into the lives of black males, I'm beginning to see black men, you know, I'm reading and writing at early ages, making sense of the reality around them. This example comes from the notebook of a young black man who was making sense of his, you know, language. And even in the later years, they're shaping their realities. This example comes from a class the teacher had the students translate the Iliad into comic book form. This particular group created a comic book called the Il. Instead of having Greeks versus Trojans, they had East Side versus West Side. Powerful. What this brand of research for me has begun to do is interrupt what I call a deficit perspective, and I want to come back to that. And that is the logic that certain individuals can and should be perceived based on what they lack as opposed to what they possess. And because of what she sees as a teeming life of literacy among young black males, Anhas Dyson argues that the literacy gap is an aberration that reflects more accurately cultural derisions in society rather than achievement ones. That brings me to the story today that I want to begin to talk about. Right. So two contextual pieces that I want to make clear. One is 10 years ago when I began, you know, or 20 years ago when I began studies on black men in literacy, the conversation was shaped in a particular way. It was almost always about what they cannot do. They're not reading, they're not writing. In fact, as they, the longer they stay in school, the gap between them and their white counterparts grow. And then I begin to look at another set of, you know, research, the qualitative research that's showing that they're reading and writing in these wonderful, these bountiful ways. Mm-hmm. And so as a scholar thinking about issues of literacy as well as education, wanting to interrupt the imagination about what it might mean to be a black male in an urban classroom, we move to resolution like Gloria Lotzenbilling's calls, culturally relevant pedagogy. Questions. Like, what if? What if we value and affirm the ways that they do reading and writing in classroom spaces? Essential hypothesis here is, if given access to culturally sustaining curriculum models that feature their literacies in classrooms, black males should do better in school. So I get an opportunity to test this hypothesis. About 10 years ago, a teacher asked me, Professor Kirkland, come into my classroom. I go into her classroom, and she said, can you help me? Can you give me ideas and suggestions for teaching these young men who sit in the back of my classroom? About four African-American men who sat in the back of her classroom. They came to school every day. They weren't reading, they weren't writing, but they were attending. And I said, what do we know about them? She said, I don't know much. They don't speak often. I said, well, can I hang out in your school, in your classroom for about a month? I stationed myself in the classroom for about a month with a notepad, you know, and an invitation from the boys. And I began to take notes. And I began to learn some things about them. And the teacher comes back to me and she says, well, we have this, you know, unit coming up on writing, and the students have to write stories. Can you give me some advice? I said, sure. I know that these young men, in the back of the classroom, they love to write raps. Can you make a hip-hop assignment? They're like, well, I don't know much about raps. I said, well, can you open the assignment up? Can you open it up in terms of genre? Can you allow them to write their stories in a genre that makes sense to them? And she says, yeah. And so she comes up with this amazing assignment. She allowed the students to write stories in a genre that made sense to them. One of the young men in the class was Derrick Todd. And Derrick never written, and Derrick didn't write in that class the whole month that I was there. And I was told he didn't write in the class, you know, before I arrived. When she opens up the assignment, Derrick wrote this. U-turn, left behind leg sprawling on top of black back mountains, rivers that run deep like Sheba's queens, and she loves open pores inside empty cups that run over. Hope like escalades that faint in darkness, that freeze in night, that frickin' morning, morning uprising, light skin, white men, blues is my brothers, black is my berry, sweet is my juice, so you turn back to me, I return back to you, I die daily for you. Whew. So I just patted myself on the back and said, good job, Professor Kirkland. Your culturally sustaining model works. But we know something about students like Derrick from the research, that many of them come to school having been rejected in other avenues of life, and they suffer from what psychologists call rejection sensitivity, certain types of outcasting. And so when the teacher did this to his poem, Derrick never wrote again. She struck a U. This poem, U-turn, told him his use of sprawling was broken, told him he misspelled pores, he misspelled light. She called him lazy. She called him lazy. And we know now where this leads. So at one level, I believe that the issue was access and opportunity, that if we brought in from the qualitative scholarship with young men of color, do it outside of classrooms into the classroom, that there would be a revolutionary pedagogical experience. But for Derrick, there was. He wrote. And when he did write, the teacher did her job, or at least what she perceived to be her job. She corrected. And when she corrected, Derrick never wrote again. And Derrick is like so many other students who are forced into this cycle of underachievement. Pedro Noguera writes about, you know, this disproportionate suspensions of, you know, black and Latino males. We know, too, that these systems of disparity don't end with just disproportionate suspensions. We know that they're 9 times more likely, in some cases, to be placed into special education. And we know that these results are recalcitrant in some ways to the test. Approximately 12% of black males test proficiently in reading compared to 40% of all other youth. And we know that these consequences do linger beyond the classroom. Nearly 40% of black males will be jobless, either unemployed or incarcerated by 2020, according to the Center for the Study of Social Policy. And even worse, we know that the consequences are tantamount to murder. The young black men, ages 10 to 14, have shown the largest increase in suicide rates since 1980 compared to other youth groups by sex and ethnicity, increasing by 180%. Among 15 to 19-year-old black male suicide rates have increased by 80%. And we know that black males are twice as likely to die before the age of 45 as white as their white male counterparts. And while some of you might say that there isn't a direct correlation between what happens in classrooms and what is the consequence in cemeteries, I would argue that the relationship between these disparities should give us cause for alarm. Why didn't Derrick's teacher see value in his poem? It's a question that I've been asked. So if it is about access and opportunity, And the teacher creates this moment where young people can bring their culture in to a classroom, only for that culture to face penalty. As a researcher, I have to ask the next, you know, practical question. And then that is, what happened? What happened? Antonio Gramsci writes about culture. I'm going to talk about this politics of culture for a second. We know that culture can be used and is used as a socio-political currency for the exchange of values, beliefs, and dispositions. We also know, based on the work of a variety of culture theorists, that culture is an essential part of who we are. Yet we know that culture is valued. Some cultures are valued more than others. Therefore, certain individuals are perceived to have greater worth in society than others. Mark Lamont Hill would call, you know, on these individuals vulnerable or disposable or nobody. And we know that the value of culture is constantly shifting, amended by some elect or elite to reflect them, their languages, their interests, etc. And I'm saying that same classroom, same English classroom, the teacher couldn't explain to me why all students needed to learn standard English, even though she would argue that they needed to learn standard English. She couldn't explain to me why Shakespeare was the most important text in the classroom, even though the students weren't reading Shakespeare. If the goal, right, if the goal of the classroom is to get students to read and to write, and we choose texts that they're not reading and they're not writing, catch what I say, if the goal is to get them to read and write, and we choose texts that they're not reading and writing, what else is going on? Antonio Gramsci begins to help us explain it, right? He has this concept called hegemony. Hegemony is the success of some dominant group or some dominant way in projecting itself upon the masses, whereby we can sense the multiple forms of oppression. Why does she embrace a standard English only, you know, on philosophy in her classroom when effective communication and students will need to understand how to effectively communicate beyond it? McDonald's understands this lesson, right? If it wants to sell you a hamburger in a hood, it's not going to do so in standard English. Right. It's going to speak the language of that community. But in some level, certain ingrained deficit ideas began to take hold. Right, Gramsci gives us some language for explaining it, right? Like this idea of hegemony, success, of the invisible notions that get reinforced daily through our practice. So at one level, the teacher is correcting Derrick, and at the same time, embracing him. And there's somewhere in that contradiction that an inequity lies, and that inequity leads to multiple forms of oppression. What I call displacement ideologies, silencings and fears, hatreds of self and others, feelings of inferiority and superiority, disentitlement and entitlement. Derrick was silenced before he wrote, and he became twice silenced after he wrote. And later conversation with Derrick, he talked about, you know, how he didn't want to write because he didn't feel that he could. A sense of inferiority, a hatred of self, of disentitlement. And I'm arguing that all of these are betrussed by the nine ideologies, missionary models, this idea or scope in the landscape, you know, of education policy where, you know, we seek to save vulnerable students. Rille argues that, you know, if my empowerment depends upon you, I'm twice disempowered. Not only am I disempowered within a system and situation of my vulnerability, I'm also disempowered because now my empowerment is dependent upon someone else. But today I want to talk about deficit theories because I think they lead us to a further explanation
of what happens in the case of Derrick Todd. And other research. I get to, you know, go into classrooms, and this work was at the same school. And at the school, there was one class I had gone to, and the school was using what's called pacing guides. And on the pacing guides were, you know, on a set of texts. And within the 11th grade, which was the British and World Literature curriculum, the texts that were mandated to read were things like Beowulf. And I go into this class, and you know, the teacher's teaching Beowulf, and she's teaching Kings, and I happen to love Beowulf, but none of the students were reading. And the young men that I was paying attention to were almost all labeled disengaged readers. And they were labeled, get this, they were labeled disengaged readers because they weren't reading Beowulf. I'm not going to read Beowulf with me this weekend. Nobody. I said the same thing, right? So. The teachers didn't even read Beowulf with excitement and enjoyment. And it was at that moment, right? I'm looking at a classroom, I'm like, these young people in the back of the room, they're not reading and they're not writing. They are disengaged readers, right? My research takes me outside of the classroom. And I'm following, I'm going with them, you know, to their lockers and through the hallways, to their homes. And guess what I find them doing? They're reading and writing. Facebook and Twitter, magazines, newspapers. Some of them read, you know, newspapers, you know, so well that they can quote LeBron James statistics like preachers quote scripture. They were in it. And they were even reading books too. Books that we weren't using in the classroom. It was at that moment that it hit me that we're not talking about disengaged readers. Might be talking about disengaged texts or disengaged classrooms, disengaged teachers, disengaged teachers. And so follow my research trajectory. It begins in a place where, you know, I'm seeing these deficit statistics around black males, you know, in literacy. And yet, I'm following this qualitative literature that suggests that they're far more literate than we recognize. And so we begin to interrupt those deficit statistics. Not as arbitrary, but as a construction of our consciousness about these young men. Then we move toward culturally relevant, culturally sustaining, or culturally responsive, whatever culturally you want to put on it, pedagogies. And we use it in the classroom, and these young men who are penalized statistically, when we change method and modus in the classroom, are being penalized as well. Even as they bring their culture into the classroom, when that culture becomes welcome. So the next set of questions are, you know, why? Why are they being penalized? Assuming that all teachers are good-intentioned individuals. What hegemonic mechanisms that inform teacher instruction and the way certain things get valued and not valued, the way certain bodies become disposable, appreciated and depreciated, the way certain knowledges happen to be that way. And we see it in our deficit perspectives. Who gets to be deficit in a classroom? Because I don't read the text that you don't enjoy teaching, or that you don't read either. I'm a disengaged reader, though I read in bountiful ways. At some point, I began to talk about a prophet approach. If you read Search Past Silence, you're familiar with this term. And I'm arguing that a prophet approach is an approach to education that insists upon what students can do opposed to what they can't. I'm arguing in some ways that this profit approach to education is a correction of the deficit theory. It goes beyond just an assets-based perspective, right? That thinks about what students bring into classroom to adding value to what they bring into classroom by appreciating what they bring into classrooms. And so now I'm at this place where, you know, we move from an interruption of the deficit, you know, statistics
to an appreciation of culture, to an explanation of how, you know, teachers continue or still can devalue students, to what happens when they do value them. This is what we know. Let's take a teacher who brings rap and hip-hop into the classroom. And the students happen to be hip-hop heads outside the classroom. My own research, I'm learning that that's not a guarantee either. It's not a guarantee either. And so now I'm beginning to ask questions about why opportunity and access are not enough. Somewhere in this question, I'm beginning to ask questions about what is this culturally relevant thing? Is it just bringing in, you know, student culture in order to instruct? Or is culturally relevant or responsive or sustaining pedagogies far deeper? We know that about 80% of learning deals with things beyond cognition. Things like developing relationships and trust. When hurting, it deals with things like healing. And we know in urban environments that far too many of our students come from socially toxic environments where out of their pipes they sip on lead. We know that the conditions within the school are as horrendous as the conditions they find outside of them. And we know that our students deal with issues of structural violence. If you're hungry, it's going to be hard to learn, even if you do have a type of cognitive sophistication. If you just saw your mother get hit the night before, it's going to be hard to learn. Even if you eventually get 6 degrees. That in terms of full responsiveness, cultural responsiveness, we need more than just the pedagogical anecdote. That structure and culture of violence is deep. It's 1001 cuts that Gloria Lachtenbillings talks about when she considers microaggressions. It's the implicit bias that many of you in the room have been considering when you think about equity gaps. And it's the number of other things that people deal with as a consequence of poverty. In a situation of schooling that deals with the cult of wealth, this idea that we've normed education, we've normed schooling, you know, based on the assumed identity of people who have more economic resources than us. Linguistic, cultural, material. We have to think about what that cult of wealth means. In this sense, I'm distinguishing the cult of wealth to the culture of poverty as explanation. That maybe our issue is that we've affixed ourselves so much to, you know, the culture of people who have money. And that's created a structurally and culturally violent condition in education that's hard to overcome. And we know that this leads to hopelessness, according to work of Sean Jenner. And that hopelessness, you know, redounds to things like violent behavior, fatalism, depression, social disengagement. Some of you do research, you go into some schools, and you know students, if you say the wrong word, they're ready to fight. Mm-hmm. Some of them have completely checked out of the educational conversation because they see nothing in it for them. They know the young man who's gone to college and still works at McDonald's, still sleeps on his mother's couch. They know him. They don't buy into it. They know the person who's gone to college like Cedric Jennings and, you know, Hope in the Unseen, who in some ways distanced himself from his, you know, brothers. And they don't want to experience that loss. They become fatalistic. And as I said before, we know that at least 60% of young black men in their school experience some form of depression. And yet we don't gear schools to respond to it. And as a result, they're socially disengaged. Jenright goes on to give us a model of what the effects of this trauma might look like. The Jenright, a student can be gone on an irregular day. And chances, if you live in an urban environment of experiencing a traumatic event, is far more typical than not. You experience that trauma, and now you're just in survival mode, floating the status quo. The argument with culturally sustaining pedagogy is that it can bring us to hope, but hope only brings us back to where that student should be. But the broken promise is that student might never thrive under the current logics of school because we haven't been fully responsive. One thing Jenright talks about is experience. He goes into a prison and he gives a talk, and after he gives his talk, a young man stays behind. This story spoke to me. And this young man, you know, is talking to Jenright, blah, 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 blah. And Jenright says he's about 300 pounds, 7 feet tall, and Jenright says he gets a little scared. And the young man begins to talk about, you know, writing. And how, you know, how he would write his daughter, you know, letters from behind bars. And this is the part that captivates me, that caught my attention. Jenright asks the young man, well, what motivates you to write? How did you become a writer behind bars? And the young man says, it's hard. It's hard for me to write because my baby was just a baby, and I won't see her until, you know, for another 25 years. Sometimes I can't even get over it. And the Jenright says, well, how do you get over it? How do you get over it? And then the young man reaches into his pocket, and Jenright says he gets scared again. And he says the young man pulls out bubbles and begins to blow a cascade of bubbles around his head. And my own research now, I'm beginning to search for bubbles. So that's what we need to locate. What are the bubbles? That point of possibility where the pedagogical imagination can get our young people past their traumas. That point of pedagogical, you know, inspiration that is truly responsive to the entire body and the apparatus of pain that young people are feeling as they experience the manifold injustices that exist outside of our schools and within them. The question I'm asking now, what are the bubbles for young black men? Where are their bubbles? And what might their bubbles look like? And I got 5 thoughts in closing about bubbles. Thought number one is that our explorations of black males in education must move beyond issues of access and opportunity. It's not okay if we stay here to explore issues of hope and healing. That would be the way he writes about the deep intimacy of boys. That somewhere within, you know, the corpus of patriarchy, we don't allow the masculine body to feel its vulnerability. We don't articulate necessarily the pain that can be caused within. When we think about boys in education, we typically and too often move away from ideas of vulnerability and hurting to get to places like healing. But King said, one of the great problems of history is that the concepts of love and power have usually been contrasted as opposites. I'm saying here is that the concepts of access and opportunity have usually been contrasted as opposites of hope and healing. What is needed is a realization that power without love is reckless and abusive. What is needed is a realization that access and opportunity without hope and healing is reckless and abusive. And that love without power is sentimental and anemic. That hope and healing without access and opportunity are sentimental and anemic. This means that culturally responsive, a culturally relevant education is certainly about access and opportunity. But it's also about hope and healing. This means that as we bring our students' cultures into classrooms, we have to also deal with the wounds that they carry into the classrooms as well. And for researchers, it means that our lenses have to investigate both spaces. Not just the romanticized possibilities of their practices, but the scars and injuries that they face from being dehumanized within spaces that they might practice and be ignored. Might take us to places we begin to explore concepts of restorative justice or restorative practice. Or my colleague Joshua Aronson is looking at mindfulness and meditation. The concept that the soul, even a black masculine soul, can benefit from quiet as a learning concept and as a learning apparatus. Thought number two. It means rethinking our understandings of the basics. No longer can we define basic skills as reading, writing, and arithmetic. And literacy, no longer can literacy be understood as simply reading and writing text. I'm a prolific writer, an avid reader. But before I became a prolific writer and an avid reader, I was first given an opportunity to fall in love with words. To allow the lilt of language to play and dangle on my tongue. That the basics are things like pleasure, play, curiosity, and creativity. And when hurting, there are things like healing as foundational principles. Here I'm making a point that, you know, within the disciplinary, you know, inquiry piece, that we have to look beneath some of the larger socio-emotional aspects of those spaces. I was in a classroom in the Bronx about a year ago, doing some field work, and a teacher is in a classroom. The students are, you know, doing work, and one young man, he's like, Miss, I got a question. He's being loud. Miss, I got a question. I got a question. And she says, we don't ask questions in here. Like, where do we ask questions? And if we begin to think about inquiry, curiosity as a basic skill, then the classroom is the exact place that we ask questions. We begin to think about things like play and pleasure and curiosity and creativity as basic skills. Then these classroom places, spaces begin to look different. Think back to Derrick, Todd, the treatment of his story. Looks different. Thought number three. It means rethinking notions of place and space in relation to schooling. That some of the crux of our investigation must deal with what my colleague Chris Gutierrez calls the pedagogical third space. that in some ways we're beginning to investigate overlaps of possibility, where what students do meet what we want them to do. Space of congruence. Thought number four. It means interrogating our assumptions about the status quo. Instead of failing students, it begs us to ask, how are we, or how are systems, failing students? Again, moving beyond a deficit perspective. It asks questions about how do we move beyond current conversations and explore new possibilities where we tear down walls. And we see young black men in new light, and light like this.
Sometimes a man can't be himself in the eyes of the sun, because sons were told they should never walk with a switch in cage in their hips. Switch through silence-filled alleyways and secluded communities under blacked-out skies. The sun isn't too accepting of my nature. Living as a homosexual black male is like a sleeping gazelle in a lion's den, but I refuse to run.
Switch. I hide in the daytime. Walk crooked towards masculinity, it's tough. When feminine tendencies won't allow me to make a fist, a devil controlling my forearm to hang low like a lynched dream. Switch.
The world evicts you from normality, turns your natural into a disease, tells you your love is a jihad and will never be tolerated. How do you tame your forest fire passion? How do you walk the streets
when the arches of homophobic stares pierce through your core,
creating this cocoon,
a hideous premature butterfly that will never be able to ascend in heterosexual skies? The testosterone filled wings that flap uncomfortably do nothing but hold me down.
So I will switch. I have followed biblical paths and roadmap searching. I still can't find a damn thing wrong with me. I met a man yesterday. He's got LL's lips and Malcolm's mind. Let my skin envelop his manhood while the hairs on the backs of our necks give us a standing ovation.
Switch. Tonight I will live life like the universe was a rainbow playground, like the colors were drinks at a bar, and I will sip until the sun explodes. Take shots until I stumble like an intoxicated skyline.
Tomorrow I will meet the man of my dreams.
Switch.
Two men disappear like sound.
October 9th, 1998, Wyoming News. Shepherd's skull is smashed with a handgun. Switch.
February 16th, 2005, Daily News. Hacked up teen found on Nostrand Ave.
Switch. October 12th, 1998, New York Times. Young man dies 5 days after he was rescued from being tied to a fence.
Switch. February 17th, 2005, New York Times. Butchered Bushwick teen on Nostrand Ave identified.
Switch. His name is Matthew Shepherd.
His name was Rashawn Brazell. Two men with exploding stars for futures. When I first heard about you, Rashawn.
Matthew.
Your death some silently as fuses. Unsightly explosions of hatred. To save ourselves, we search for splendor.
Rashawn,
he didn't want to kill you, but when you held him in your arms, he heard the music and caged in your bones,
the same music you switched to.
He just wanted to free the melody, electric song gnawing at your joints.
He did it for the music,
separated life from growing neck, from skull, back, from spine.
I swear he did it for the music, limb to bag.
Matthew,
they couldn't understand your brilliance, the way your intelligence backstroked in your cranium.
You were bright like an intoxicated skyline.
Those pistol whips cracked your top open like a sunflower seed. Click clacking a desert easel, cock back swinging you into a fatality.
There were two men who loved the both standards. The media calls you hacked up,
pistol whip,
butcher,
gay bash.
They forgot to mention that you were human. So today, we pitch your names into the wind. Listen to the syllable switch off the tongues of every little boy who started out to switch in public. Because sons shine a hydrogen bomb bright, even when they switch.
And so as we begin to interrupt the status quo, we begin to see something else. Beyond that new light, we see a multitude of stories that as we research young black men, we're not researching one thing. Researching many things, many stories, many possibilities, many forms of masculinity, many forms of being. Because the consequence of a single story is this. It robs people of dignity. It makes our recognition of our equal humanity difficult. It emphasizes how different we are rather than how similar we are. Thought number five. It means that we must conduct our work like our lives depend on it, because too often their lives will. Thank you.
Incredibly edifying talk. Thank you, Dr. Thank you, Jim. We have some time for dialogue. We have about 15 minutes.
Here. David, thank you so much. I'm definitely very, very moved. I wanted to publicly thank you for giving me space last year to work with you, brother, at NYU. You opened me up to a breadth of new scholarship. As an Asian man from a marginalized community, you get it, and I appreciate you.
Thank you.
The question I wanted to ask you was that in your presentation around the politics of culture, right, you talk about hegemony. And I'm wondering if that silent treatment for white supremacy, patriarchy, and if it's so, is there a reason why you didn't name it? Question mark.
It's a good question. Hard question. Let me first thank you all for letting me be here and scream at you for about an hour. Usually, I get passionate about these ideas because part of it is my story. And, you know, I think Peter acknowledged it. You know, we do this work for a reason. You know, and the consequences are human. I stand here, you know, not because I'm like the brightest cat, but because of people like Peter and you, you know, who put in work to ensure that opportunities and that the momentum of those isms that, you know, Peter mentioned, you know, don't take hold, and the gravity of them don't pull all of us in. So I want to thank you all. You know, so when I talk about hegemony, you know, is it, you know, larger ideologies, white supremacy, patriarchy, you know, imperialism, global capitalism, Eurocentrism, and we can continue the cacophony of things, and why didn't I name them? You know, I certainly couldn't. You know, but I wanted to reach and appreciate, you know, what so many of our teachers do. So often, when we do research on teachers, you know, we beat teachers up. And I don't know if that's necessarily fair. You know, many of our teachers are victims of white supremacist and patriarchal, you know, ideologies. And at the same time, there's a complexity here. Many of them are good-intentioned people.
Yeah.
Really good-intentioned people. You know, who, because of invisible forces like hegemony, the success of this, you know, particular way, do their work and try to do it to the best of their ability, and that work can still be dangerous and damning to individuals. And I think that part of that selection or choice and its intention is to value what teachers do. As I critique them, as Cornel West would call it, a loving critique of them, and a loving critique of that work, as it might propel research and knowledge around teacher practice, you know, with respect to the ways they engage Black males. And so, certainly could have, you know, said that, you know, her treatment of Derrick's, you know, poem, you know, was pointed at, you know, a particular racial politics, and that would have stood true. But I feel that I also need to, you know, value this very good intention, you know, individual who, you know, went to a professor and said, hey, I need your help. Can you help me teach these young men that I'm currently not doing a really good job with? But, you know, of course, the conversation around racial hegemony, you know, patriarchal hegemony, and all the other hegemonies, you know, stand in place. Jonathan.
David, thank you for coming down, and thanks for a great talk. I want to bounce an idea off you and just see what you think. You know, it seems to me like a lot of what you recommend falls broadly into a tradition that a lot of educators would call progressive. Child-centered rather than teacher-centered, active rather than passive, and most of all, rooted in the community, broadly defined, rather than the school. But it also strikes me that many people who wrote in that tradition aim to help people who, because we live in a society of inequality, right, make the society more equal, and help those people gain some of the resources that they didn't have access to before. So my question is the goal here to help students that have been, that don't have the same opportunities as others, to help them gain some of the aptitudes that we see on the first slide that describes a thing called the achievement gap,
yeah,
or is it to question whether they should?
Right,
what's the goal here?
Yeah. So I got so many answers to that. Like, I think you and I, we've had this conversation, you know, a couple other times. You know, I'm glad that it gets to continue today. And I think that's a really good and fair question. You know, I'm gonna answer it in three ways. The first thing that I wanna tackle is this idea of equality. The goal here is inequality, right? If I go back to a slide, there's a difference between equity and equality. And the idea of, you know, equality, treating all students equally when they have different disadvantages, doesn't feel fair or just to me, right? So the goal might be equity. You know, in creating a situation of educational equity, you know, where students who might need a little more support, you know, get it, or might need different supports, get them. Beyond equity, there's another slide where I tore down the wall. Maybe we need to move the conversation beyond just giving them a little more support, to looking at the structural situation that has created the situation of inequity in the first place. Well, why can't they see, you know, on the baseball game? It's not that they need boxes to look over the wall, it's because there's a damn wall in front of them. There's a wall in place. So the other part of the question is, how can we begin to tear down the walls? And that is, you know, a conversation about the system, interrupting the system, and doing some design work to create new points of vision, you know, for young people, so that their opportunity from where they stand can be best realized. The second part of your question is I tried to get into it some, and it's this concept around, you know, what I call, and I'm beginning to call it, a cult of wealth. We've so normalized a few things in education. One thing that we've normalized in education is this idea of being middle class and being, you know, and having some point of resource. That the objective and the goal in some ways, you know, is to get to middle classness through education. And so the curriculum, what counts as knowledge, what counts as practice, what counts as disposition, is this thing that's typical to middle class individuals. What I'm questioning is whether or not that's valid. Should that be the goal of education? Middle classness. And how is that, you know, romanticization of middle classness, you know, something that I call a cult of wealth? Are there practices that we should appreciate, that people who live in, you know, structurally vulnerable situations and environments, are there practices that we can begin to appreciate in education? Like the spoken word poem of Derrick, or other knowledges that might exist, that might, you know, fundamentally, you know, destabilize and unsituate the conversation in education. It seems to me the answer to this question has been yes, at particular moments in history. In fact, the foundation of, you know, English education, for example, is based on proletariat language and literatures. When Shakespeare was writing in the Globe, he wasn't writing to middle-class individuals or to the crown. In fact, he was writing to people who existed in the hood, in the gutter. The same thing with Chaucer and Canterbury Tales. When he writes this text, he's preserving a language of the people. That is obstruction to the language of conquest. Right, the Norman invasion, 1066, the Battle of Hastings. We know the Norman conquest and how French, you know, takes hold of, you know, the British Isles. He's resisting what is formal and standard. Same thing with Dante in the Divine Comedy. He's not writing in the high language. He's not writing in Latin. but Italian, this guttural dialect. At some point, we found ways to appreciate the so-called culture of poverty in ways that have made sense historically to the dispossessed. We see those principles and those logics play out in other places. Conquest mathematics, a colleague of mine has written about the ways that, you know, suffering people have been conquered. Their concepts and principles around, you know, numeracy have been appropriated and made useful. And so, at another level, I'm arguing for an interruption of power as it relates to how we understand schooling and whose culture, whose knowledge, whose understanding of the world, you know, gets to sit centrally, you know, in the conversation of education. The third principle is around this notion of achievement gap. I don't know if you all saw it, but there's a fundamental critique of this idea. You know, for at least 8 years now, I've been, you know, wholly critical of the notion of achievement gap as it exists within a white supremacist logic. Right, in some ways, it centers the performances of, you know, white youth, whereas, you know, black and Latino youth get defined against it. That becomes fundamentally problematic, because if we define the achievement gap in a different way, whites might find themselves on the bottom cast of that achievement gap, right? If Asians, you know, set the norm in particular places, right? In particular Asians. Sorry, Peter.
Yeah, you know, I was thinking about that. I was
going to
challenge you later, but that's all right. We can talk about that later, all right.
Right? So when we begin to think about that, right, what it does is the agenda of education becomes around, you know, how can we improve, or how can those individuals who sit at the bottom cast of education be improved to mimic those who we put at the top? Well, what Gloria Laxon-Billings does when she moves to educational debt as opposed to achievement gap, she's arguing something different. That some students are being valued, and they're being paid in education, an education that looks like and that is responsive to them, and others aren't. And how can we begin to pay that debt? And what she's arguing here with this educational debt as opposed to achievement gap is that the students who enjoy a culturally relevant education, which means that their history, their knowledge, their language, their practices, their home practices get taken up in school, they get to see and experience schooling in ways that are different than students who don't. In a sense, their debts are being paid. Their debts aren't. And this isn't a conversation about gap. It's a conversation about debt. And the debt redounds to us. I hope that answers something.
It does, but Gramsci doesn't agree. Gramsci, he was a political radical, but very much of an education conservative.
Yeah.
And Gramsci would disagree with all this. That doesn't make him right. But he thought that people on the bottom wouldn't be able to leave the bottom until they acquired more of the skills and the capital that people on the top have.
And his argument around civil society working to, you know, achieve that ends, you know, for the dispossessed was part of it. But I'm only using Gramsci's notion of hegemony in a particular way, in a way that people like Michael Apple use, right? Abandoning the other type of political and cultural Marxist, you know, lenses and language that Gramsci uses, and that Gramsci might get wrong.
And back in.
Dr. Kirkland, thank you so very much for your talk.
Thank you.
Towards the end of your talk, you talked about the bubbles. I was very curious about that. Is that evidence, or are those more conceptual? Is that a concept? And then secondly, if you can talk about how that shows up in your research on black men and boys.
I think it's both. I think it's conceptual and it's evidence-based, right? So when Jen Wright, you just came out with a book, you know, called Radical Hope and Healing. You know, I would take a look at it, and the book is thick, you know, with data, you know, and research around, you know, individuals who live in situations of poverty and trauma, right? What we know, and what we're beginning to see within, you know, socio-emotional learning circles is the effects of trauma on education. and the multiple forms of trauma. We're also beginning to see, you know, from some of the neurodiversity and neuroscience research, some of the effects, you know, of, you know, cultural difference in terms of how the brain might assimilate, you know, learning. So there is this growing body of evidence within the human sciences around, around various ways that, you know, things like connection, relationships, food and ways of having food, you know, does influence, you know, the learning processes, right? So there's this body, there's a growing body of literature on this stuff. I would refer you to Niobe Way's, you know, work, who, you know, looks at, you know, boys, you know, and socio-emotional learning. My colleague Sibel Raver, you know, has some really interesting work where she ends with resilience. I don't, you know, but some of the work around trauma, you know, as a factor in the educational equation, I think is right, you know, right on. Pedro Noguera has been looking at, you know, things like trauma, you know, in education. We did a study, you know, in Compton, California, where we saw, you know, at least 25% of the students within that district, you know, experiencing, you know, at least two forms of severe trauma per year, influencing how they experience schools. And so there is this growing bed of evidence, and there's a pre-existing body of evidence that we already knew. You know, if you live in, you know, situations that are, you know, contiguous, you know, that you would experience school differently. I rarely quote Daniel Patrick Moynihan, and, you know, forgive me for doing that. You know, even, you know, in his 60s report, you know, we see the effects of poverty, you know, on education. And I'm not appealing to a culture of poverty argument. I'm arguing that, you know, the extreme forms of poverty create structural, you know, barriers and structural violence, you know, to how one does experience school. So there's a manifold evidence, right? And there's manifold evidence particularly aimed at, you know, some of our most vulnerable populations. And when we put black boys in that category, we see it there too. What was the second part of your question? I'm sorry.
Yeah, just how does it show up in the research you're doing on black boys?
Right, and so the work that I'm doing now, I've been unsatisfied. I've been extremely dissatisfied with just saying, hey, do rap and hip hop in the classroom and it's gonna work pedagogical magic for these boys, because it's not true. So the way it's showing up in my own work is, you know, I'm beginning to push it and ask different questions. Like so if the research is saying that this should help, and it helps marginally, you know, in the most extreme or romanticized cases, but it doesn't necessarily give me a trend line, and it doesn't help truly, what is the actual issue? Increasingly, I'm beginning to see that there are, you know, intersectional issues. The violence of, you know, being you know, discriminated against because of your race, and, you know, because of economic oppression, you know, of being assigned the status of nobody or disposable, as Mark Lamont Hill, you know, talks about, of seeing a theater of violence play out daily. You know, now we see it dramatized on television, where, you know, we see, you know, men with holes in their chests, where we see daughters, you know, screaming to, you know, mothers, it's gonna be all right, mommy, while their father's in the front seat with a bullet hole, you know, through his body dying, right? You know, so in my own work, I'm seeing that this trauma is playing out. I'm beginning to, you know, beg questions. How can, you know, the trauma question, you know, get involved in some of our conversation on culturally responsive and even critical approaches, you know, to education and educational intervention?
I think we're just about out of time. Before everyone goes, Dr. Sean Harper couldn't be here today, so I have the honor of David Kirkland with this wonderful poster representing his entire faculty or students is, do check out the work that the Metropolitan Center is doing at NYU, right? How extensive it is, how engaged it is. Not to be intimidated, but to be really inspired about the ways in which an academic career does not just have to be about one's individual trajectory, but can really be about working in solidarity with communities. It's a quintessential example of that. Let's give Dr. Kirkland another round.
I want to thank you all again for having me here and for your thoughtful questions and for just for everything. It's been such a warm day. Thank you again to Dean Pamela Grossman, to all of you. Thank you.